Okay, good morning, and thank you very much for joining us. Depending on what area you're living in, I think in the country, maybe in Lagos, southwest of the country, in the past 4 weeks, the power situation has become remarkable, to put it discreetly. There are areas that haven't had power at all for 4 weeks, or intermittent power, erratic power. And then in the last 1 or 2 weeks, there are many areas will tell you that, what are you talking about? We haven't seen, 5 minutes of power. Not even a minute, never mind 5 minutes. Why has it come this bad? Yes, output has dropped, but then we also hear that there are personnel issues as well. And that might have fed into the whole crisis, is what it has become. It's particularly bad because as the power generation drop and distribution, reduction, where if not total cancellation, this has now been complicated by the fuel situation. Nupen and Pengasin also have their own issues which are being sorted out, and that's probably a topic for another day, maybe tomorrow. So you can't even buy fuel as easily to power your generator. To find out what exactly is going on and how soon we're going to come out of this, well, we thought we'd get two people who are, who can really give us an overview of the subject. We got Joe Ajero. Mr. Ajero is General Secretary of the National Union of Electricity Employers, and he's the factional president of NLC. He's a factional president of NLC. Thank you very much, Joe, for coming on.
Thank you.
And right next to him is Sunday Oduton. Mr. Oduton is a barrister. He's head research and advocacy director, Association of Electricity Distributors of Nigeria. So all those guys that should bring the electricity to into our home, you represent them.
Yes, I do. Thank you very much. Good morning, Nigerians.
Indeed, it is our pleasure. Joe, to sort of understand what the issue is, I mentioned the drop in supply. We understand that, but it's been complicated further, hasn't it? Because it's gotten to the level where many, many, many households have not seen just 1 minute of power in the past 2 weeks at least.
Yeah, I think it's sad that it could happen that way. The people that took over the power sector, most of them didn't know that it's an essential service. They looked at it as a business. And those of us that operate the unions know that it's an essential service. That is why even before we take action, we'll give them notice, so that we can apprehend it. But it appears that they were still looking at it as commodity. You can dispense with the staff, you can deal with them without a consequence. So and when you deal with them, and they are the people that operate the machines, and they protest, definitely it will affect power output. But added to that is that some of the distribution companies, because of the economic factors, refuse to even pick load from the little being generated. And I say this without mincing words. If you go to the grid,
yes,
and maybe Ikeja is allocated 400 megawatts. Now, if they take 400 megawatts, they will pay back to the market operator the worth of 400 megawatts. Now, if they refuse to pick 400 megawatts and pick 100 megawatts, they pay back 100 megawatts. Now, why would they pick 100 megawatts instead of 400? Because they want to pay less. Now, because the money they are going to make from 400 megawatts is the same thing they are going to make with 100 megawatts based on estimated billing.
Okay.
Now even when...
Based on that vexatious estimated billing.
Yes. So even when situation is normal, and you still have 3,000 or whatever megawatts, majority of them, and I want the transmission company of Nigeria to come up, the majority of them will still not pick the load allocated to them.
Okay. So while you were saying what you were saying, Joe, it happened that Sunday was, there were areas he was shaking his head. I wondered if you disagreed with something.
Very much so. First of all, I want to appeal to Nigerians who are on the receiving end, including myself as a customer of a DISCO, for putting up with this typical Nigerian situation where we don't put the country first. And one of the things that really pains me very much is when we go out to the public and we deliberately misinform the public. My brother here should know better. The issue of load rejection that he's talking about
is an old story. That's a real controversial point.
It's a very old story. I mean, the facts are there. the data are there, and you, the media, can do more investigation about this.
But when he says, when we're as, talking as
about
union, that,
no, no, when we're talking about load rejection, mm-hmm. load rejection happened when we were fighting the issue of what we call imbalance penalty. That was when these codes were being punished for taking extra load. Now, we are even generating far less than what we need. Why wouldn't we take the load? It is in our interest to take as much load as possible at these codes, so that we can supply as much and then make as much money from supplying so much.
How about that? Talking about estimated billing. Yes, estimated billing.
You see, people use that again in a very unfair way against the discourse. First of all, let me talk about whatever you get from any billing. You're talking about tariff, you're talking about money. 60% of whatever we take is going to the generation companies. 60? Anyway, 60%. So people need to understand that in the value chain of electricity, we have the generation companies, the Transmission Company of Nigeria, and the distribution company to which I belong. We only take 25% of whatever money we collect. We are just collection agents. 11% of the money goes to the transmission company, 60% goes to the generation company, while the remaining 4% goes to the NEC, the other stakeholder NEC, MBET, and all the rest. So why won't we take the load? Mm. So the generation companies are there. The National Control Center is there. You, as the media, can find out from them,
yes,
and
yes.
You know from both of us, okay. Who is saying the truth.
Okay.
So that is that.
So that is
what I want
that
to talk about is from why is there the darkness? That's what we should be talking about.
That is what we are trying to get to the bottom of.
In the last 2 weeks, the supply has dropped. There are two major problems. Problem number one, and we need to simplify it, mm-hmm. so that I don't go into technicalities and jargon that people don't understand. Number one, it's nothing to do with us, the discourse.
Nothing.
We can only distribute what has been generated and transmitted to us.
Okay.
That's number one that people need to understand. Basically, the fourth major problem is vandalism in the Niger Delta area. Once the gas pipeline are vandalized, then you are denying the generation companies the essential gas that is required to fire the power station. Remember, Nigerian power generation is mainly from gas fire stations like thermal stations, like Egbe and all the rest. We have the hydro. Hydro consists just about a quarter of all that we generate in this country. So we need gas. Gas is very essential. And when those guys, when they bought the gas pipeline, that has nothing to do with the power sector, security services, the communities where those things happen, where they condone criminality in this country, and nobody's talking about that. That's number one. Number two problem in the last 2 weeks, why we have not had light, is the union, and that's one of them here. This is my brother here. They are the one who have decided to sabotage this country by ensuring that because of an issue in Ikeja Disco,
that's
what
talk.
I'm saying, please, because of the problem with in Ikeja Disco, and the problem there, I would blame Ikeja Disco anyway, openly
mm-hmm.
here.
Mm-hmm. How?
What I would say is that perhaps they need to communicate more with the unions and whoever they need to let them, because what they are doing in Ikeja is fantastic. Perhaps people don't know what they are trying to do. If, as I go around, people complain a lot about our staff. I was here the other day, and complaint was made that our staff were corrupt and not this and this and that. And I said, we won't go to heaven to hire Malaika or angels. These people are Nigerian. Now, what do we now do? The discourse now go ahead and conduct competency-based assessment to ensure that staff are competent in what they do. If I do that and I have to disengage 100 staff and I employed 700 staff, those 700 staff, are they not Nigerians? Ikeja has employed so many staff, and people are talking only about those that are disengaged. Why about those that are
but
employed?
Not about
are
those
they from
that
Niger?
Were
are they from Ghana? Are they from America?
So what you're saying is that in the equation, whereas there might have been some disengagements, you also hired many, many more
than double
than were disengaged.
Yes, in the last 1 month at Ikeja. The records are there.
Well, again, what is the perspective of the unions? Because it does seem logical. But how about how would you react to that part about actually the unions might be sabotaging us?
Well, there was a point he made that the discourse have nothing to do with power if power is not generated. I want to tell him that most of the transformers by the discourse are off and they are bad. Now, in any community where the transformer is not working, they will not have supply. And it is the responsibility of the discos
to keep those transformers
to keep in order.
Up and running.
Yeah, even if you have power generated, transmitted, with the problems with the transformers, which is the responsibility of the discos, there won't be.
So you're saying that the facilities of the discos in many cases is lacking.
And I want you to go to communities in this Lagos. You know, find out whether their transformers are working. Find out areas where they have not had supply for the past 3 months. But that's that, by the way. On what you said about
the implication of this is a lack of maintenance to save costs.
A lot. Now, the second point is what he said is union issue. Now, the management or the companies were registered by the Corporate Affairs Commission to generate electricity. I'm licensed to unionize the workers. Now, the two groups should realize that we are serving Nigerians. By the time any group decides to take any decision without considering the other, the other will equally react.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he has talked about assessment and evaluation, and I want Nigerians to look at the issue of is assessment or evaluation in a workplace, which is annual, for the purpose of SAC. Now, how come in that about 200 or 400 people in Ikeja were sacked are that bad? Now, why will you give me a target?
How about the re-engagement part of the equation?
That one, we understand that one. By the time we see their records,
700.
We are not aware of that.
If 200 were disengaged,
It's not a condition.
Okay.
It's not a condition. Now, what I'm saying, if you assess people and you evaluate them and you say, go, is that the basis? Do you have a condition of service that stipulates that if you do this, if you don't do this, you go? They don't have it. And I want this to be clear.
Mm-hmm.
An organization that doesn't have a condition of service can't wake up to say, this is what we are doing. This is whether you like it or not, you take it. And that is exactly what Ikeja did.
Let me just ask you, because you, as you say, you're licensed to unionize.
Yeah.
When workers are found to be not be fit for the purpose they purportedly are engaging in, surely you can't blame anybody auditing the situation and saying, look, we've got to take efficiency, surely.
It doesn't have.
Does efficiency have a part in what you're talking about?
Sorry, assessment must have some level of transparency, reliability,
okay,
and it must be valid. So if there is no supply in a community,
mm-hmm,
and you give me a target of making 2 million there, that community won't pay. If their transformer is off and I'm a marketer working in that community and you're giving me a target, or I'm a marketer, you give me 1,500 customers to cover and I can't cover it in a month.
Yes.
And that's the basis for my evaluation.
Okay, can you comment briefly, please, or if you want, copiously, on this whole matter of efficiency of the workforce that you unionize?
Yeah.
Is it important to you?
No.
Efficiency
is very, very important. But efficiency must go with the materials for you to work. I'm sorry, my brother. 3 weeks ago, part of this problem and crisis we had with them, people died in Isolo. No equipment. And they were asked to climb. Those people that recommended that it was because of lack of equipment, that because of the upsurge,
mm-hmm,
and these people were killed, were poorly sacked.
Mm.
So it's like you are asked to go and get water out of the rock. Now, if you are open, and we are talking of evaluation, and we know the basis for this evaluation, it gives us charm. However, you don't sack more than 10 people anywhere in Nigeria or declare redundancy without negotiating with the union.
Okay, I hear you. Now, before, Barrister, indulge me one more question because it's important. I wanted to ask Joe, as a union man, you've said efficiency is important. You also have acknowledged that there has been a total lack of power in the past 2 weeks or so. Total. That's your men protesting. Now, I want to know what it will take from the union's perspective, from your perspective, to get this situation back to what we used to call normal, bad as that was.
Yeah, you see the issue of...
Can you give it to me in brief?
The issue of lack
what
of...
What will it take to get the situation back to where we used to be of intermittent power supply?
No, the issue of power, there has never been steady power supply.
But this is a total blackout.
Never. Now, this issue of total blackout, there is a combination of factors. Like he said, people were protesting, they are not working. You don't expect everything to be normal, to be stable. Now, the gas pipelines, according to him, were vandalized. Now, that brings you to policy. Now, policy, why will you build a political power station that you construct power pipeline for almost 500 kilometers to where there's a a power station, and you expect maybe soldiers to line up in that pipeline. Now, if I carry a power station to my community and there's no gas in that area, then we have to construct a pipeline. And every day we'll be talking of vandalization of pipeline when we don't have control over it. In terms of policy, we have to change and build power plants where we have gas.
Now, that's not going to happen tomorrow, even as desirable as it.
Yes,
so I was asking you this maybe simplistic question of what would it take, Joe, from the point of view of the unions to get back to, just like the petrol people have said now that it's all right, we sorted it out, there'll be fuel.
Yeah,
from,
sorry. We have
what can we say?
Sorry, there's a combination of factors. In the case of Ikeja,
so it's not an easy answer.
In the case of Ikeja, for instance, yesterday we reached an agreement. Now, agreement is that there is a committee to look into this issue of the people you sacked. There is a committee to go into condition of service, in that order. The same thing with Ebwi, because Ebwi happened to be the main corporate.
Okay, so until those issues are resolved.
Now, work has resumed, but even when you resume and there's no power supply, there's no power being generated, that will not translate to electricity in our houses.
Okay, but now you've landed that, well, we have resumed, we the workers, if I got what you're implying, we the workers have resumed now, but because this is quite a number of factors, it's not just
technical
us.
Okay, question.
It doesn't look like anything is happening, but you are saying that there has been a change.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, let me quickly make the point that what I wanted to add was that when Joe called his guys to go on strike, it did something to the value chain of the electricity supply. The value chain, as I explained earlier, we have generation companies, which are private six companies. We have a transmission company of Nigeria, which is still in public hand, like the old NEPA, but privately managed by a company called Manitoba Hydro of Canada. Then we have the 11 distribution companies. Now, the transmission company...
Joe, you're shaking your head vehemently.
This strike that they're embarked on, we have the National Control Center in Oshobo.
Yeah.
That is where, using a layman term, that's where they turn the switch on and off. What those ones have done, the workers there, courtesy of Mr. Joe, they have gone on strike. That's why you have not had light. And nobody is coming out to say the truth about that. When the NCC goes on strike, that's an essential part of this economy and the country. To me, it's a big deal.
It is.
And when they go on strike, what happened then was that Egbin had to shut down two of their units. Same thing with so many of the other power stations all over the country. They had to shut down because there's no one to pick the load. One transmission is not there. How can you wield the power from the point of generation to the point of distribution? So Nigerians that are listening should know that there has not been light, not because we are not working. There has not been light because the union have decided to call their guys in NCC Oshobo to leave the switch room and go home.
Now
that's what they have done.
Now
and that can only happen in Nigeria. It's a funny country.
Okay. Well, you were shaking your head vehemently when that was
happening. Yeah, he was trying to tell you of private companies and public companies. Manitoba Hydro, he talked about. Manitoba Hydro.
Contractor.
It's a contractor.
Yeah.
He's not Canada.
They are from Canada.
They are not. You know, you see, Manitoba Hydro Canada, you know, is a company owned by a municipal in Canada.
Yes.
And the people you are seeing here are not Manitoba Hydro Canada.
Okay.
Those are the people you people
assembled. But they are contractors.
They are the people you people assembled here.
Okay.
Now, the
we've got to this you people level
now. Yeah,
all right.
Yeah, the issue of privatization or what? Government still maintains 40%. Of the privatized firms. And 10% is reserved for the workers, which they have equally not allowed the workers to take control of. To a very large extent, when you say the interest of Nigerians, now you should treat Nigerians, you know, it will not be without the workers. Nigerians, workers are Nigerians, you know, governments are part of Nigeria. Now, when you see Nigeria, like he was telling you, it can only happen in Nigeria. If you think it's an essential service, the people there are performing essential service. That is the more reason you should treat them the same way. Now, when you see it as essential service, that it is the machine that is essential, and the worker is not essential.
Then the workers are going to take some action.
Yes.
And that's why we're where we're at
now. No, they allow the machine to work for you. You know, so that's the situation.
Okay.
Here.
So now you said yesterday you were talking about Ikeja in Ikeja, for example, and hopefully that's the way it's going on all over. You said you put down some suggestions for how to resolve this whole matter.
Yeah, by management and union.
By management and union, yeah. That you've set up committees where they can come and resolve this. And so work will resume today.
Yes.
But the essential aspect, very much, and I know this argument, this conversation point comes up when we talk about, for example, medicine, when we talk about health, when we talk even about fuel. And this is another one. You don't buy it at all when people say you guys are trifling with, you shouldn't be doing that. You're taking undue advantage.
Well, if you say it is essential services, you won't put it to the callous private man's hand.
Okay.
Yeah, that was why Section 16 of the Nigerian Constitution was still put all these areas as commanding heights of the economy, and which say that the state must participate in the commanding heights of the economy. Now, if you decide to now make it as a commodity, you say, oh, Ajero, handle this, you handle this. You turn back to tell me that this is essential services. The essential services, instead of allowing those people to equally come up with their own plans, you handed over what belongs to all of us, public utility, at no cost, to the hands of some individuals. And you expect the individuals to use the name essential services to equally, you know, undermine the workers, to enslave them, to work without condition. And you see the essential service. For goodness sake, the right to say, oh, today I will not work, still resides with the worker.
Okay.
And the right of the employer to say, no work, no pay, no work, no job, still reside with the employer.
Thank you very much.
So I agree with him that between the workers and the employer, there must be consultation regularly, there must be constructive engagement. But I said it from the beginning that we need to put Nigeria first. A situation whereby you take advantage of this country and throw millions of Nigerians into darkness for selfish reasons, for reasons that are definitely selfish.
Well,
it's not about fighting for the workers.
You're calling it selfish reasons. I hear you.
So when you talk of throw them into darkness,
it's
assumed as if there was light before. When you say throw them into darkness,
there was an epileptic kind of light.
There was light. Let me quickly talk about
epileptic light. We're nowhere near
the action of the workers took place on Monday, between Monday and Wednesday. Now you are telling me that last week there was light. I want Nigerians to call.
I said there was vandalism in the last 2 weeks,
which was caused by the workers.
And every day,
because he made the point that they can't do anything if they're not getting anything.
There was vandalism.
That's what you're trying to address now.
The power station that shut down in the last 2 days did so because the union had called.
Yeah, we have issues. We have issues with
NCC.
Yes.
We have issues with.
I'm not saying they don't have issues. When they have issues, we should find a way of resolving issues without throwing the nation into darkness. That's what I'm saying.
Because Joe, you see, we could be selfish
in doing this. Egbe went to staff quarters where the workers from transmission company were and removed the roofs of their houses. And rain was falling into their properties. Now the workers said, okay, if you have removed our roofs, and we supported them.
Why would they do that? Because they want to get rid of them.
Yes, because they said sorry. Okay. Because this.
Because if an employer goes and takes the roofs off,
those ones are transmission staff. No, those ones are transmission staff who, if they don't work there, whatever a bid generates, you can't evacuate.
Okay, now I got to go on break now, so that I can come back and then add your calls, add your questions and comments and observations from home, trying to get to the bottom of. How long is this total blackout going to last, and what can we do to just come out of it as soon as we can? We'll be right back. Okay, welcome back. We've been trying to get to have this conversation go with Joe Ajero and Barrister Sunday Odunta. Joe is a unionist. He's General Secretary, National Union of Electricity Employees. Mm-hmm. And Sunday Odunta is a legal practitioner, and he's Head of Research and Advocacy Director Association of Electricity Distribution Distributors of Nigeria, the guys who are supposed to bring the power right into our houses, and they've been, as far as we're concerned, falling down on the job. But then Sunday says, hang on, there's an explanation, and he spent a lot of time explaining it, and he says, very, very little of this is our fault. And of course, Joe, as you've been hearing, has been saying that, are workers not human beings? Do they not have flesh and blood? Let the machines work now. If the machines are all important, let the machines work. If you're not going to take the human beings that perform this essential duty as part of an essential equation and treat them accordingly, then my union is going to object. That's where we're at. Did I paraphrase that?
Yeah, you got it.
You know, well. And of course, we want to take your calls as well. Clearly, it would have been lovely and ideal if there had been a cordial, amiable relationship between the discos and the unions. That's the ideal. But is it this forever that there are almost like opposing poles? They want better and more for the workers.
No.
You want to get away with as little as possible.
No company can exist without workers. And no worker can exist without companies. So we need each other. I think they need to wake up to the new order, the new world order, all the world over, privatization.
Mm-hmm.
If the public utilities were working very well under the government, there was no need for them to privatize.
Okay, one moment.
Even now, if they think privatization is not working for them, let them return it back to the public hand.
Okay.
Let's have NEPA and darkness and corruption.
Mm. Okay, Akin wants to join this conversation, calling in from Ogun State, I believe. Good morning, Akin.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Thank you for calling in, Akin.
Thank you, sir. The comment there says something about...
By the way, how is power in your area of Ogun State? Have you had power for the past...
The past, let's say, 1 week now. I've been running on Gen. Even I'm using Gen now.
Okay.
I want to ask him, when they were selling off this power, utilities to their colleagues, to their colleagues, why didn't they cry? And again, sir, I want us all to know one thing. Both you and those in the oil sector, whatever we made of this country, we will all be responsible for it. That is just my say. Thank you.
All right, then. Thank you very much, Akin. Warning that we can't keep going on like this without something breaking. I think that's the essence of what he's saying. That look, and I think it's relating to the whole essential nature of it.
I wanted to link it up to what he was saying about privatization, you know, and the world order, you know. Although I wouldn't know from the angle he's trying to situate it, the issue of privatization of electricity all over the world. I've not seen a country that privatized that you have 170 million people. And they are privatizing 4,000 megawatts. Now, 4,000 megawatts at worst could have been our base power. And Nigerians are still going to pay for it. Today in the US, 250,000 megawatts base power controlled by the government. Now, to the extent that when there is conspiracy, especially as the discos will do now to increase tariff, and they insist that they must take 100% tariff increase, the government can stabilize the system. You know, with that 200, get to the armories, the hospitals, the schools, the social, some of these areas. But today, what we saw was take that 4,000 megawatts, which Nigeria said is inefficient NEPA, hand it over to private individuals, the same inefficiency.
So we have no base.
Now, between that time and now, no new power plant has been constructed by any of these people. Now, the gas power station we are talking of should have been an emergency situation. The hydro is there, the coal is there, other forms of power generation are there. But here, we're even considering gas. And gas is very expensive to maintain. And now, if we get it wrong, you know, with all these policy issues, and we say privatization is the answer, now we have privatized. And we are here, you know, like he's talking of world order. We're no longer talking of the ideology of privatization. We have privatized. Why don't we go ahead and give Nigerians electricity after 3 years, almost 3 years after privatization? We can't be talking about the concept privatization today, because these are the warnings and signals we gave out as a union before privatization, that look, you can't privatize under this condition. You can't privatize without even metering the country. You know, if you privatize without metering the country, it's like you are subjecting the people to the vagaries of the market.
Mm.
So these are the issues that are on ground before now. Okay. So how do we tackle it?
Before you come in, let me bring in Alhaji Subaya, and then you are come to you. Good morning, Alhaji Subaya.
Yes, Mr. Yori, good day, sir, Mr. Yori.
Yeah, thank you for calling.
Yeah, good day to your guest. Let me tell you, Mr. Yori, a serious government in anywhere, you understand? I'm having your guest there may mention of essential services. The work essential services, be you NEPA, be you taxi driver, be you working in oil company, be you doctor, it's essential services. And in fact, the serious government is supposed to unionize this category into any union. It's a saboteur. You know, one of your man there, he may mention of economic sabotage. What these people are doing is economic sabotage. And remember, Mr. Yori, that man that is there, that is the same
thing.
I
hear you well, Jonathan. Unfortunately.
Hello? Hello, Mr. Yori?
I know you're speaking loud, but we can't hear you very well in studio here.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Yeah, you are hearing me. Hello?
Please go ahead. Go ahead. I think we can manage.
What I'm saying is that, look, essential services.
Okay, it's better now.
As far as electricity worker is concerned, as far as doctor is concerned, as far as petroleum workers is concerned, they are selling essential services.
Yes.
And although a serious government supposed not to allow this under head union, because they are affecting life and property of everybody. So let me tell you, Mr. Yori, you see, I'm happy your man there. He made mention of economic sabotage. That man that is there, that is the same thing he did to that union man, that is the same thing he did to President Jonathan. He's supposed not to be in service now. Look, I am serious with what I'm talking about. Anything, electricity, petroleum workers, taxi drivers supposed not to be doing here. The serious government supposed to be united and pass a decree. It's nonsense. You cannot call out into answer. Have a nice day.
All right, then. Thank you very, very much. I said I'd come to you, and I have to find out what Joe found so amusing, but I'll be patient. Coming back to you.
Well,
because he seemed to...
The last caller just said that there are some essential services that should not be subjected to the wishes and whatever the union wants, so that we don't turn the country upside down. And this is one of them. For me as a person, I'm not against the union. And for us as an industry, the disco, we are not against the union, but we are for common sense. Common sense number one. The government and Joe's colleagues and himself, they have run NEPA and PCN from ECN. They've done that for several years, over 50 years. For them to have decided to privatize the government, it means that they know that they have failed. And when they privatize, this happened when? Just 2.5 years ago. It's a very long journey. The reform process is a long journey. It's like going on a 5-step journey. You're in the second step anyway. So it is a lot of things will take time. And I agree with him. He said something very good. And if you notice, Joe was not part of those who were on the street to protest the increase in tariff. And I remember we went to the Senate hearing with the late Minister of State for Labor. And in that room that day, we were not many. I didn't see Joe there. TUC was there, NLC was there. Joe did not go with them.
Yes.
He is new.
Yes.
He knows. He knows the truth. That's why he did not join those ones who are only fighting for their pocket.
Okay.
So
I got to interrupt you because Musa from Ikorodu has been waiting for a while. And then I'll come to you, Joe. Good morning, Musa.
Yeah, good morning, Yori.
Thank you for calling in.
The area I want to comment from, I want your guest, that's the person representing the DISCO, to clarify this other area. The debt that customers were owing up to 31st October 2013, prior to handing over to the new investors, who is the owner of those debt? Because as I speak to you now, the installed prepaid meters in some premises, and this issue of outstanding estimated balances are not being discussed. As soon as these meters are installed, the 40 units that comes with that meter is exhausted.
Yes.
Those customers are compelled to pay these outstanding balances. In some cases, they're up to 300,000, 400,000. Whereas these balances are very contentious Don't forget that one of the major problems of the past regime prior to this handing over is the issue of billing. And as I speak to you, 2 years after handing over, they have not been able to resolve the issue of billing Nigerians transparently. So let me tell us, the outstanding estimated balances as at October 3rd prior to takeover.
Yeah.
Who is the owner of that debt?
Okay. All right then, thank you very much, Mr.
Every debt owed in this industry up to the 30th of October 2013, those debts are dealt with by a body known as NEMCO, Nigerian Electricity Liability Management Company. They are based in Abuja. And if you go online, you see them there. That is very clear. Anybody who has any claim,
one moment, please. Let me
pre-takeover claim.
Yes, let me get why Joe was shaking his head at that point you made.
See what,
is that an accurate point or not?
I think it's
pre-takeover
wrong
is what I'm talking about.
So I think it's wrong. Those people took over liability. The debt owed the then PSN.
It's part of liability.
You guys, for instance, somebody has not paid his bill. Let's take this for 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
And when he's paying it, he's not paying it to NEMCO. He's paying to any of these distribution companies. And if I got the person well, that was the question he was asking. Now you inherit this, you inherit, sorry?
No.
That's not question.
Okay, in the meantime, Shola from Ipaja, good morning.
Very easy to resolve.
We're waiting on you, Shola.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning.
Are you hearing me?
Loud and clear.
Hello?
Shola, we can hear you loud and clear. Can you see us?
Yes. Yes, what I will say is this. Hello? What I will say is this. I think we are all confused.
Except for you? Or including you?
I think we are all confused. Including
you?
Myself.
Okay.
Because this issue of, is it NEPA, is it GENCO? That is the network. It's not my fault. Okay, if you are listening to me. I don't know. The issue of NEPA, I want to see it as some people on the net trying to manipulate us. Do you know that this increment, the tariff of changing our NEPA has been done 5 times, 5 good times. And every time they will tell us once they increase, it's going to be good, NEPA is going to be right, just like our petrol. We are not seeing the truth. Even when it was regular at 2,400 megawatts, 3,000 megawatts, you can have this megawatts, but the distribution is another big problem. Who are really working on the side of the people? Everybody is working for the agent. Everyone is working for the government. But what of the people? What have we benefited for all these years of either they are increasing and the power is going to be regular? Not to even talk of them going on strike. Who is on our side? Who is on the side of Nigeria? I think it is time for us to really focus on what is to be done, who is to be held responsible for all of this mess. People are dying. Children are dying. We careless. You see nation, just because of one soul, the president, the citizens, the workers, they have a feeling. But Nigerians, do you know for this fight that is off now, the hospitals are not working fine, and there is no petrol to run generator. A woman is going to be delivering now, and there is no way the operation is going to be done.
Okay, Shola, thank you very much for calling in. I appreciate you and your call. And indeed, you are expressing the anguish of a lot of electricity consumers.
Yes, I understand that, and I really feel for the caller and other Nigerians.
But you're trying to imply that
What we should be looking at.
Because he made the point about 5 times and you can't argue that.
Let me talk about let me explain that.
And it has not improved with every increment.
One of the problems with Nigeria and Nigerians is that we don't put the nation first. A government decided to sell off the entities to private investors. They drew out an agreement. And in that agreement, they said, from day one, November 1, 2013, you have what they then call a cost-reflective tariff. Guess what? They didn't do it. So when you don't have the appropriate pricing for the product and you continue to undersell the product, 10-year tariff structure that goes off the first 2 years and start coming down from the third year to the end. This tariff that we have now is what we should have had from November 1, 2013. And that is nothing to do with the union. I'm not blaming the union for that, because you have to be sincere and be honest, and we have to be fair to them.
Okay.
It is the government.
Okay. Peter Ojoju, just before, you know, Joe comes in. Good morning, Peter.
Good morning, sir.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to contribute in this topic.
Yes.
Like in my area, in off Aynot Street, I just noticed that what you people do is just, you know, the NEPA office there, what they do is just to extort money from their customers. We've not been having light for over 2 months now. What I did was I had to invite them to come and cut off my line. They've cut off the line. I told them to go with the wire. I've been running my gen 24 hours and I've had peace of mind. They talk about giving people prepaid meters. And I discovered that I've gone there to request for this prepaid meter. What they keep telling me that they will have this by November. And they're enjoying it. They're enjoying this part. This their expensive piece. Once they come, they all they know is how much do you have. Sometimes they even collect the cash on the street. The corruption in the power sector, the earlier the president come down and then look into this properly, the better. If they don't want to meet anybody, they don't have any right to come to your house and cut your life.
That is
pure corruption.
Okay. Thank you very much, Peter. Joe, your turn now. The essential aspect of the product, commodity, whatever service that we're talking about right now, you are not unduly impressed about that.
No. I started with that when I said that we appreciate the essential nature, and that is why when these issues come up, we give notice so that the other people.
Okay, so you're giving time people to react and even, avert
fine, even the
crisis.
Fine, even the Minister of Power. So, and Minister of Labour, by the Labour Act, you know, they have every right when you give notice, because it's mandatory in the sector, essential service, to give notice for them to apprehend it, because that's the position of the law, before it metamorphoses into real industrial crisis. And these are issues. So if they refuse to do this, both management And in all these instances, we might have written 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 letters. Most of them are not acknowledged. And you now wonder the type of people working in such areas.
Because when the crisis now comes, then we start coming on television, we go on radio,
fine.
Newspapers. Ola from Ikorodu, did I get that right?
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning, Ola. Thank you for calling in.
Yeah, please. I have a very strong feeling that the old privatization arrangement that was done by the previous government was screwed up in the first place. The discos that are in charge of electricity distribution have shown clearly that they don't have the technical capacity. And, you know, in this government of change, the right thing is to call off the whole privatization, you know, because up to 3 years after the privatization, they have not been able to do the basic metering. They don't show any seriousness. Now, I would have to tell you one thing. The power sector is a very important sector. You don't have to leave it in the hands of politicians. The owners of the discos and gencos are politicians. They can use electricity as a political tool to shut down any government.
Yeah.
So in a normal situation, the government should ensure that the discos are the electricity is in the hands of foreign neutral investors.
Okay.
So that these people cannot exploit it as a political tool.
Okay, Ola, thank you very much for calling in. And this one I have to say to Sunday, how do you plead?
Well, first of all, we should always have some clarity. And that is the way it is all over the world. When you privatize an entity, the private person that comes is the so-called investor. The investor now employs the services of operators who are going to do the day-to-day management of the of the industry. Now, the one for Nigeria is not different.
Yes, but that whole point about
we are an
almost total lack of technical capacity.
No.
Alleged.
Those are things. You see, when people say it, Either they're saying it because they don't know the real issue in the sector, or they don't know the rot of 50 years and they expect us to correct those rot in 2 years, which is not possible.
And so you would throw, Mitrin, of blackmailing the government in power now, because of political...
No, I'm not throwing that out. Okay. I'm not speaking for the investors. Mm-hmm. Let's get that clear. There's a different line between those two. I'm speaking for the operators, the discos. And we that are operating the discos, we know where we are coming from, and we know where we are, and we know where we are going. We're embarking on aggressive metering. But I have first said something about metering. Until that's your neighborhood, you will never know it exists. Why are we where we are? After the point of takeover of these entities, we had 5 million metering gap, which means that in the days of NEPA and PACN, people were building houses, they were connecting there without giving them meters. When you build a new house, you are supposed to be given a meter from day one. And when they failed in doing that for several years, before selling off, we now have so much. But that's not an excuse.
Yeah,
I'm just saying that it's taking time.
People need to be patient on that.
But if anybody have any problems with the investors...
You wanted to react
Yes.
Please, can you just hold the point? Because Rahman has also come on from Aja. So I'll come directly to you, Joe, as soon as we've heard from Rahman. Good morning, Rahman.
Good morning, Uncle Yemi.
Thank you very much for calling in.
Yeah, money. I just want to make 3 points. Well, I just want to make 3 points, Dr. Yeri. Yeah. The first of it is that we know these sold discos on the whole utility of NEPA was being sold to Chronix. Yeah? We know of the one that Eco Disco was being sold to Fashola Trend. So Fashola cannot even say anything about that. And that's why he came on here to say rubbish. I respect him so much, but I was so convinced, so disappointed in him when he said we have to give them. You can imagine in my house, I'm holding my bill as I'm talking to you now. I've been given 21,000 naira to pay under a new tariff of 25 naira 79 kobo from 15 naira. It is unfair. And they decided to reduce. Initially, they were giving 1,500 kilowatts. Now they reduced it to 700 kilowatts so that I can also be in par with what they were giving to me before. I know coming month, what they will do is to increase it a little before you know I'll start consuming 40,000 naira in a month. My salary is just 80,000 naira. So if I'm out of 80,000 naira, I'm consuming 40,000 naira. Uncle Yemi, how am I going to support to survive? So what I'm telling the whole Nigeria now is that let's tell them to come and take their wires. It is not operation, no meter. No payment, no billing.
Okay. Rahman, thank you very much.
Come and take their meter. Every Nigerian should take that now.
All right.
We've already been living in darkness. Let's live in darkness for the next 6 months, whether they will not survive without us.
Thank you, Rahman, for calling in. You'd want to react to that, but I have to go to Joe.
Yeah, you see, if we finish all these things without President Buhari revisiting the privatization process, he will not be doing Nigerians any good. Now, the person I wanted to react to talked about the whole process of privatization. We were told that privatization was based on three prongs. You get people with managerial ability, technical competence, and FDI, foreign direct investment. I want to tell you on good authority that no $1 came into this economy because of privatization. Now, you see a situation, people borrowed money from Nigerian banks to take over Nigerian utility companies. Now, I want them to tell us those with the technical competence and managerial ability. Most of the names you are seeing have never managed any utility company in their life.
Okay.
Now, if you look at it based on these three areas, because I wanted to align with the person,
yes,
you will discover that we are just chasing the shadow.
So it looks like we're going almost like round and round in circles. But I must give you, we've run out of time now, but I must give Sunday the last word.
What I want to say, for me as a person, I don't want to go into the politics of ownership or no ownership of
And you can hear the anguish coming from home.
What?
People don't feel very good about the discos.
Well, they will not feel good about the discos because it is us, the discos, that they know. And that's why I can
understand. And I think when you did your breakdown the other time at the top of the program, you explained that the DISCOs, what is the percentage?
DISCOs take only 25%.
And so 75% goes elsewhere.
60% goes to generation companies because they also have to pay the gas suppliers.
Okay.
But you don't see them.
So you think people don't understand the issue?
They don't understand the issue.
They're directing their agro at the DISCOs.
And let me say something about electricity quickly, which is that
in the next 15 seconds.
Please, to have electricity, when everything stabilizes, when you have electricity, you must be ready to pay for it. It is not free, it is not easy, and there are too many thieves out there.
Nigerians have long said that they will happily pay. They will happily
pay
if they are assured that
even government don't pay. Military don't pay. They are not paying.
Okay.
We are all 60 billion naira. Nobody's talking about that.
So everybody is taking the discourse for granted.
That is what they are doing. Nobody's paying.
I want to thank you, gentlemen, Joe Ajero and Sunday Odunto, especially for the enlightenment that's come out of this 30-40 minute conversation. So many aspects of not being able to just put on the switch and have light. There's a lot of talk going on. Joe has said that in Ikeja, at least they've started and everything is like back to normal, but there still are issues.
Within 3 weeks we should be able to know whether they are resolved or coming back to business.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. I'll see you tomorrow, God willing, with a fresh edition of the program. I'm Yori Folani. Bye-bye for now.